from the future. I came here in a time machine that you invented. Now I need your help to get back to the year 1985.
Time travel has always been fascinating because it's something that I think we all fantasize a little bit about, and that makes it really interesting. And, you know, when I started studying film, I realized that telling a time travel story in a movie lends itself to doing it probably better than in any other medium.
Bob Zemeckis and I, for years, had discussed the idea of doing a time travel movie, and we were never able to figure out sort of the hook, what was going to make a good subject for a time travel movie. Well, after we made a movie called Used Cars, I was back in St. Louis visiting my parents, and my father went to the same high school that I went to. And I found his high school yearbook in the basement. And I'm thumbing through it, and I find out that my father had been the president of his graduating class. I didn't know this. And I'm looking at him and thinking about the president of my graduating class, who was a guy I'd have nothing to do with. And I thought, would I have been friends with him if I had gone to high school, or would I have just hated his guts? So when I got back to California, I'm telling the story to Bob, and he's going, yeah, that's really interesting. So we just got going with that, and that was the germ of the idea. Well, Used Cars didn't do too well at the box office, but Columbia Pictures loved it. So the head of Columbia, Frank Price, said to us, as soon as you guys have another idea for a movie, bring it to me first. I want to hear about it. And by, I don't know, September of 1980, maybe October, we said, okay, let's go tell Frank Price about this. So we set up a meeting. We go in to Frank and we tell him, basically, this kid goes back in time and goes to high school with his parents. And his mother falls in love with him instead of his dad. Within days, we had a deal to write two drafts of Back to the Future, Columbia Pictures.
All writing is hard, but our working relationship is truly collaborative. You know, we really check our egos at the door and we debate everything, and we do it understanding that it isn't just, you know, to win, it's to make the movie good. And so we don't have a problem with that.
We use the index card method of plotting. So we had a big bulletin board in our office, and we would say, okay, we know, for example, Marty goes back in time. So an index card goes up, says Marty goes back in time, and then towards the end, Marty goes back to the future. That's another card. So we said, okay, wouldn't it be cool if he invented rock and roll? So we put up a card saying Marty invents rock and roll. Well, we need to establish that he can play rock and roll and that he wants to play rock and roll. So that means that somewhere on the bulletin board before the card that says he goes back in time, establish Marty's desire and ability to play rock and roll. Same thing with the skateboard. If he's going to invent the skateboard, show him on the skateboard. So these pairs of index cards would come up.
But to write a screenplay like Back to the Future, it was just an immense amount of very hard, back-breaking work. I mean, there was nothing really fun about writing the screenplay. It was really hard.
We had a first draft probably in 5 months. They asked us to make changes. We spent another 6 weeks or so, had another draft in spring 81. And basically they said, well, you know what? It's a really nice, sweet story, but we're kind of looking for raunchier comedies these days. No thanks, we're gonna pass on this. So we said, okay, let's go take this around. And we were getting the same exact message from everybody. This is just not for us. But among the people that we showed it to was Steven Spielberg.
They brought it over to me and they said, nobody gets this. Maybe we're crazy. Will you read this and let us know what you think? And I read it, and it was a very unusual story. And yet it was based on a lot of old-fashioned principles of family, coming of age, getting your first car, all the dreams and desires you have for your own life, the dreams and desires your parents might have had but didn't succeed in realizing. And it was about the generation gap, and it was about the major disconnect between our generation and our own parents' generation. And that was all done through an amazing object lesson, which was this sort of accidental trip back into the past.
He said, oh, this is terrific. I'd love to be on board and help you guys get this made. Bob and I were in a position where we'd done three pictures with Steven. I Want to Hold Your Hand and Used Cars, which Steven executive produced, and 1941, which we wrote for Steven. And none of these movies were big hits at the box office. So we were getting a little superstitious, thinking, well, if we do another movie with Steven and it bombs, we'll never get another job because we'll just be those two guys that only work because their pal Steven helps them set up their project. So we were totally candid with Steven and told him that this is why we didn't want to attach him to it, and he understood completely. So we're taking it to producers, we're taking it to studios, everybody's saying, take it to Disney, take it to Disney. So finally, Bob and I said, well, let's go take it to Disney. So we set up a meeting, and we go in, meet with an executive, and we sit down, and he says, are you guys insane? You've got this scene with the kid and his mom in the car. This is incest. We can't do this. So it was too extreme for Disney.
Well, I think it was a tough sell at the time because Bob Gale and I had no success credentials.
So Bob Zemeckis said, look, I got to direct again. I got to direct something. And I'm going to direct the next decent script that comes along. That was Romancing the Stone.
And that was a very successful movie. So suddenly studio executives thought Back to the Future might be a good movie. So it had actually nothing to do with the material.
And Bob is saying, well, let's go back to the one guy who always believed in it. Let's go back to Steven.
We had this good friend in Steven who's a filmmaker. And a filmmaker can see the work of a director and read a screenplay and kind of imagine what that movie might look like. So he always understood what the movie was.
And we said, Steven, you still interested in doing Back to the Future? He says, damn right I am. And so we set it up. It was the first Amblin project at Universal set up with Steven not directing.
I guess they call you Cal.
No, actually, people call me Marty.
Obviously, the most important character is Marty McFly. And every young actor in Hollywood wanted to play him. And we did an exhaustive search and read a lot of people and just trying to find the right person.
I was shooting Teen Wolf, and we were in Pasadena, and we were shooting, and I had all the stuff on my face, all the wolf drag, rubber and hair, and I'm feeling miserable, and I can't eat. And to make matters worse, just down the road, there was a scouting crew there for another film, and we found out that it was for this new Spielberg-produced film called Back to the Future. Then I heard that Crispin Glover was in it, and I knew Crispin from other things, and I'd worked with him before, and I thought, man, Crispin Glover's in this Steven Spielberg movie, and I'm like Teen Wolf.
All of us seized upon Michael Fox right from the beginning, but he wasn't available. He was doing a very successful television show at the time called Family Ties that had been created by Gary Goldberg.
They wanted to offer me Back to the Future before I even did Teen Wolf, but they had spoken to Gary, and Gary couldn't release me from my contract, and Gary kind of had figured out that there was no way I could do both.
So we begged and tried to see if we could cast Michael, and we couldn't. And then we started really looking for somebody who might embody many of the qualities that Michael had.
But we were given a mandate that we had to make the movie by a certain date. And if we didn't make the movie by a certain date, they would cancel the movie. So being a young and a hungry filmmaker, and maybe having a bit of an inflated ego, I thought, well, I can make this work.
So, you know, as you do when you're making a movie, you finally make a decision, and that first decision was to go with Eric Stoltz.
We shot for 5 weeks with Eric. He was totally professional, but there was just something missing.
He's a magnificent actor, but his comedy sensibilities were very different than what I had written with Bob, and he and I just never were able to make that work.
And he showed me the first 5 weeks of footage cut together, and he just said, I don't think we're getting the laughs that I was hoping we would get. And I looked at Bob, and I realized that he was absolutely correct, and I said, Bob, what do you want to do?
So I had to make this horrific decision, which was very heartbreaking for everybody. But luckily, I was able to convince the studio to let me reshoot 5 weeks of work.
So we went back to Gary Goldberg, and we were on our knees begging, we need Michael, we really need him. And Gary said, okay, look, I'll tell you what. I'm going to let Michael read the script. And if Michael wants to do it, with the understanding that family ties always comes first, and if you guys are willing to make that accommodation to us and shoot around our schedule, then I will let Michael read the script and we'll see what happens.
So at Christmas time, I was called into Gary Goldberg's office, and Gary gave me an envelope, a manila envelope with the script in it. And he said, here's the script, take it home and read it. If you want to do it, and, you know, so you have my blessing. I kind of went like this, put it down on his desk and said, I love it. It's the best thing I ever read. And that was it.
And we literally set up this plan where we had a station wagon with a bed in the back. And Michael would finish his tapings on the TV show. Then he'd get into the station wagon and he'd drive out to the set for night shooting.
I'll probably work until about 4:35 in the morning. And then I'll sleep more until about 6 o'clock.
From the moment that I said that I would do it, it just kind of, I was caught up in this cyclone of activity and creativity of the highest level. Just really brilliant people, brilliant filmmakers, brilliant artisans. I mean, it was just so much stuff. And then at the same time, then there was a practical matter of shooting it, which was I'd work at Family Ties from 10 to about 5, and then go over to the set and get there probably about 6 and start shooting and work all night till about 4 or 5 in the morning, and then go back and get driven home and carried in the house and dropped in bed and woken up in the morning and put in the shower. And I mean, it was just crazy.
Somehow, thanks to Michael Fox, we made it work, and he turned out to be the perfect Marty McFly.
He's a reactive character. He was written that way. He reacts to everything. I mean, because he's a stranger in a strange land. So he's basically the alien in the movie. And it takes an actor with a perfect sense of comedy timing and a really great actor, because it's been said that acting is reacting. So he was able to understand that the humor was not in the punchline, it was in the reaction.
And he can sleep in my room.
I gotta go. Thanks very much. It was
I never tried to tackle any of the physics of it, or the temporal logic, or the space-time continuum, or any of that stuff. But from Marty's point of view, I understood the story. I mean, I understood what was driving him. I mean, it was basically, you know, girls, rock and roll, and skateboarding. I mean, it was not far from being the major focuses of my life just a couple of years earlier. And two of them still were.
Kids, we're gonna have to eat this cake by ourselves. Your Uncle Joey didn't make parole again.
Our approach was, all right, let's find young people who are, you know, 18 to 25, who have really good acting chops, and we will get them to act old with makeup and so forth. And we read, again, every actor of that age, and Leah came in
Marker.
And just blew us away.
Well, I just think it's terrible. Girls calling boys Marty, it's just terrible.
I got involved with Back to the Future, I believe, because I was doing a movie called The Wildlife with Eric Stoltz at Universal. And apparently, Zemeckis and Spielberg were looking at Eric Stoltz, and they said, who's that girl? That's the story I heard. And so they called me into audition, and for some reason it just clicked for me.
When I was your age, I never chased a boy or called a boy or sat in a parked car with a boy.
When we were shooting the first scene where you see Lorraine and as the older mom, and, you know, it was a really difficult scene because we had to hit the comedy, but we had to show just how sad she was, just how bad her life had become.
And it was then that I realized that I was going to spend the rest of my life with him.
And that's one of the interesting things about comedy, and one of the interesting things about working with Bob Zemeckis is that you have to kind of weave, you know, you have to know the reason you're there in that scene, and you have to hit the jokes and then hit the depth. Luckily, Bob was there to, like, tell you what points to hit with a lot of precision. You know, he demands a lot of precision. And so I loved working with him for that reason.
Now, Biff, now, I never noticed that the car had any blind spot before when I would drive it. Hi, son.
Crispin had this unusual way of talking and these strange mannerisms, and he was George McFly. There was no question.
I love Crispin, and I loved working with him before I did Back to the Future. He did some episodes of Family Ties, and I did a TV movie with him. And people think about the way he acts, the way he talks, and all that stuff. But it's in his head. I mean, it's just he sees things differently and thinks about things differently. Like one point when I chase him across the street and onto his porch step and tell him that he's got to take her to the dance, he had this broom and he wanted to give a sweep with the broom, like this elaborate kind of sweep. And Bob said, "What's with the broom?" He said, "Oh, it's a sweep of indignation." And we said, "Okay, well, that's cool." I mean, I was fine with it, but you know, you just after a while, you didn't try to figure it out. And again, it gave me more reactive.
Hey, what the hell is this?
Breakfast.
Wendy Jo Sperber was my daughter, and she just was really funny. She just was totally hilarious and so comfortable. And because she knew Bob Zemeckis and Bob Gale, you know, I was jealous of her because she just, like, knew them and, like, could joke around with them, and I was still a little bit in awe of them.
With Wendy, we met on I Want to Hold Your Hand, and we became brother and sister, like, right away for the rest of our lives from that moment. And then Bob hired us for Used Cars, and then we got hired for Back to the Future, and we always kept saying, like, how lucky we were, you know, first of all, to have met Bob Z and Bob Gale.
You realize what would happen if I hand in my homework in your handwriting? I'd get kicked out of school. You wouldn't want that to happen, would you?
Everybody has a bully in their school.
Would you?
Now, the interesting thing is that Tom Wilson is absolutely the total opposite of Biff. He's the most gentle, good-natured, decent guy you could ever meet. But he had this persona that he put on that was intimidating, and he plays it so straight, that's why it's funny.
So why don't you make like a tree and get out of here?
Yo, Jennifer.
Marty, don't go this way. Strickland's looking for you. If you get caught, it'll be four tardies in a row.
I had auditioned for Young Sherlock Holmes, Gremlins, and Goonies. They were all done by Amblin, and it got down to me and one or two other girls for each role. So when they called me in for Back to the Future, it was all the same producers, and I was like, hey, it's me again. And then when I got the part, they talked to ABC, because I had just done a pilot for ABC called Off the Rack, and they wanted to make sure that the pilot wasn't getting picked up because they were going to film at the same time. And ABC said, we love the pilot, but it's not going to get picked up. You can cast her. They cast me. And then ABC changed their mind and picked up the pilot. And so I had to back out of Back to the Future and turn it down. So they had to recast my part. I did 6 episodes of my series. But when they let go of Eric, they recast me.
Party's up for you, Miss Parker. And one for you, McFly. I believe that makes 4 in a row.
In 1984, I was doing the David Mamet play, Glengarry Glen Ross, on Broadway. And we had run about a year. And then I got a call from Robert Zemeckis to do this little movie, Back to the Future. And I understand that it was because of my performance in Prince of the City that they thought of me for this character.
No McFly ever amounted to anything in the history of Hill Valley.
Welcome to my latest experiment. This is a big one, the one I've been waiting for all my life.
I was doing a film in Mexico City, and I got a call from my agent saying that he was sending a script, which of course is Back to the Future. And the script arrived, and I just had no interest in it. And I put it aside, and I just, that was that. I was going back to New Haven and do a play, you know, where real actors belong, all that stuff. And a friend said, never leave a stone unturned as far as the business goes. You never know, you know. So I read it, and I thought about it. I thought, well, the least I can do is go back and meet Bob Zemeckis. And it was very engaging. He exuded confidence and intelligence, and just a certain rapport I felt immediately with him. And I felt, I'm in good hands here. This is something that, if this man is involved with this project, it's something I should do. And as I do with any character, you know, I read it, I begin to think about, what did this guy look like? What are his characteristics? And almost right away, Einstein was a no-brainer. And my other thought, there was a renowned conductor by the name of Leopold Stokowski. I remember I presented these thoughts to Bob Zemeckis, and he just like, okay.
This is it.
This is the answer.
There's no jokes. We tell everybody, Bob tells, you're playing this completely seriously. And you watch Chris Lloyd's performance, he's taking it totally seriously. He believes everything that he's doing.
But you never knew what Chris was gonna do until the camera rolled, and Chris would do something on take one and take two that he would never do in rehearsal. But just so that we could understand what Chris was about to do, we would roll the camera during rehearsal, because unless the camera was rolling, Chris wouldn't really give you anything close to 100% of his performance.
And because of the energy he had and the focus he had, I could see why he couldn't do that for five takes of rehearsal for the sake of the lighting guys and the camera guys.
But it worked out fine because, you know, Chris, once he found what he wanted to do, was very consistent and would keep doing it over and over again.
I suppose Jane Wyman is a first lady.
Whoa, wait, Doc.
And Jack Benny is Secretary of the Treasury.
I felt there was a need for a certain zaniness. I mean, Doc was sort of constantly in crisis.
21 gigawatts!
He had this excitement, and that kind of drove the physical life in whatever way it went. I didn't think too much about it. I just went with that, the energy that came out of that kind of crisis mode.
Are you telling me that you built a time machine out of a DeLorean?
It was an important character in the movie. Obviously, it's the device that sends our hero on his adventure. So there wasn't like a lot of serious thought going into should the car have a grand entrance. It was just always assumed in my mind that it would.
One of the things that pleased me was to see the car for the first time. I made sure that all of the details were brought out. We would cross-light the various functioning parts and so forth. It wasn't as if they just took a car and said, okay, inside this car somewhere is the time machine. It had been very thoughtfully designed. They took the trouble to make the car sort of an offshoot of Doc Brown's character.
In the early drafts, it was not, the time machine was a time chamber. It was not a DeLorean.
In the draft I read, it was a refrigerator.
And I didn't have a problem with it, but Zemeckis and Gale weren't satisfied with it. And they were doing their old pacing back and forth. Bob was behind the typewriter and Zemeckis was pacing and trying to figure it out, and they couldn't figure it out. And I kind of got bored and left.
And Bob said, you know what? Wouldn't it make more sense for this to be mobile?
Next thing I knew, a week later, they gave me some revised pages. And they had turned the time machine into a DeLorean.
Looks like an airplane without wings.
As far as designing the car, you know, we just wanted it to look like it was something that could actually look like a time machine, and also something that looked like it was built in someone's garage. And the third thing was that it had to look kind of cool.
That car, its lines are very clean. It's not a sculptural form. It's a very simple, almost boxy kind of shape. And I think that it made a good kind of a canvas to put all that crazy stuff on top of.
We received three of them in October of 1984 and brought them to my shop. We had some lovely drawings from Ron Cobb, and Andy Probert was very, very big on it.
And the drawings, they weren't made with the idea that here are these specific parts we want to put in these specific places. It was about the feel of the thing. So it was like a scavenger hunt to go to surplus stores, electronics shops, all these places where you can find used things, bring the used things to a workshop, and start putting them on the car.
And then our crew built it and made all the parts work and made sure everything made sense and was properly attached for all the rigors of the filmmaking that went with it. And Bill Klinger I hired to do all the electronics. We had a team of about three or four guys that had nothing but putting in all the electronics. We started with three DeLoreans for the very reason one was going to be our hero car. It was going to have a full complement of all the electronics, all the design elements, all those pieces that told parts of the story. The second car was going to be used exclusively for driving shots and stunt work. And don't worry, we'll never see it up close.
Action!
Then, in addition, we had the C car, what we called A, B, and C car. The C car we used for the process work. And we just literally kept sawing it in half like a sausage as the camera moved forward to right over Michael's shoulder when the scarecrow in the field comes up on the windshield. It wasn't outside, it was actually done on a stage. And so that was the process car, and that had very little in it.
I gotta tell you, I hated that car. I really hated it. You hear that friggin' sharp metal box that, you know, if I just went like that, I'd just jam my knuckles and I just ripped my hand up. And also it limited the gears, so it would only be low gears, and I'd be revving high at low gears and thinking that it was gonna crap out.
Then came the next conversation, which is what exactly is time travel gonna look like?
When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious shit.
And we met with ILM and talked to them, and they said, well, here's some ideas. And that was one where Bob and I quickly came to the conclusion, you know what, it's not about the visual effects. It's not about how long does it take him to travel through time. He's traveling through time, it should be instantaneous. So there is no time travel sequence as you see in other time travel movies. It's like that. But one of the various ideas that ILM came up with was a fire thing, and we worked with Kevin on that. There was something interesting on a sort of a primal level about that, and it just constantly got refined and worked on, and we knew the idea that we had this neon on there, the neon ought to glow and do something. And ILM came up with some image where bolts were shooting out, and it was sort of like opening up a hole in the space-time continuum, and the DeLorean was going to go through that. So that's sort of what you're seeing during time travel. That's how it happened. Universal said, okay, we want to do the sequel.
You've got to come back with me.
Will you guys do a sequel?
Where? Back to the Future.
And we said, well, if Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd will sign on for a sequel, yes, we'll do a sequel. Because if we have Marty and Doc, we can figure a story out. If we don't have those guys, there's no movie. So we went to them and they said, if you guys are doing it, we're in. Sign us up.
DeLorean? What the hell is going on here?
Once we saw the response to the movie, it was kind of a foregone conclusion that it was going to happen. That made sense to me. I mean, I got that. At the time, and now it seems so normal for people to lay out franchises, and before they even see the light of day, they know they had a franchise. And I remember having conversations with Bob about what it would be about. And so, you know, it's something I look forward to.
So we said, let's see who from the first movie will come back and do the sequel. So we contacted Leah, and she said, if you guys are doing it, yes, I'll do it. We contacted Tom Wilson. He said, if you guys are doing it, yes, I want to do it. We contacted Crispin Glover's representative, and it was a little different with Crispin. Crispin decided that he should get things that were way out of line for an actor of Crispin's stature to be asking for at this point in his career. So I said to the agent, go back to your client, call me in 2 weeks, and let's talk something more reasonable. So 2 weeks goes by, and she calls me back, and she says, I'm sorry, he doesn't want to budge from that. I said, okay, thank him very much, and we'll just write George McFly out of the sequel.
I just want to know one thing. Where's my father? Where's George McFly?
We said, okay, if we have Lorraine and we have Biff, but we don't have George, George has to be dead.
No! Oh, please, God, no!
And that is the reason that George McFly is a tombstone in part two.
How about a ride, mister?
Jennifer. Oh, you a sight for sore eyes.
I was supposed to do both sequels, and my mom got ill. In fact, there's websites dedicated to whatever happened to Claudia Wells and why didn't she, you know, reprise Jennifer Parker, but I left the business at that point. There was so much going on in my family, and I backed out of everything.
When you do a sequel, there, you know, are obviously characters that you're going to bring back, hopefully, but sometimes they're not available, sometimes they don't look the same, sometimes they're not acting anymore, and that's another challenge, you know. Do you just hope that nobody will notice, which is kind of the case with Marty's girlfriend? We just thought, well, she's not available, she's not working anymore, and we'll make it work.
Well, what are you talking about? What happens to us in the future?
What, do we become assholes or something?
Oh, no. You and Jennifer both turn out fine. It's your kids, Marty. Something's got to be done about your kids.
We had no choice, so we had to try and find somebody. I mean, we found, you know, Elizabeth Shue, who came on for Claudia on the second one. I mean, she's a wonderful actress. So, I mean, I thought that was fairly seamless as far as that goes. The George thing was a little bit trickier, and it was more about figuring out how we could do this. It's one of the reasons he's upside down. We thought people wouldn't be able to tell as easily if he's upside down.
How did he do that?
Oh, out on the golf course.
Bob and Bob came to me one day and they said, we want to design a device we're calling the OrthoLev, which we will have McFly hanging upside down, and it needs to travel through the house. He'd be able to go from room to room to room, and he's gonna always be on this and be upside down through the whole deal. So we had to put track, we had to hang track in all the sets and be able to hang someone upside down and travel him along in shots through the house, so that was kind of a fun deal.
I actually wrote a draft of Back to the Future 2 where the third act of it was not going back into the first movie, but going back into the 1960s, where Lorraine is a flower child, and she's protesting the war in Vietnam, and Marty gets thrown in jail. There was a whole thing to that, and Bob read that draft. He was making Roger Rabbit, and he said, well, you know, this is okay, but we can do something that nobody's ever done before. We can actually, with a time machine, go back into the first movie and look at it from a different point of view. Wouldn't that be cool? I said, yeah, that would be cool. And then Bob said, you know, it would be really great as if we went into the Old West after that.
1885! September 1885!
Well, when Bob and Bob sat down and they laid out this whole sequel, and it was too long.
Bob and Bob handed me the sequel script. You know, it was like 185 pages or something like that. And of course they said, we have to make cuts in it, but read it anyway. Because they always liked me to read, you know, the result of all of their mad science. But this was a very complicated plot, and it existed not only in the future, but in an alternate present that we've affectionately called Biff Horrific. And then it went into the Old West. And it just seemed like two movies.
Two movies that Bob and I loved when we got out of film school in the 70s were Richard Lester's Three Musketeers and Four Musketeers. We thought that was really cool that they shot those two movies back to back at the same time.
And then now you look at Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings, and everybody sort of looks at these ideas as franchises today.
We said, that's what we should do. We just keep shooting. Let's just keep shooting. And thankfully, we had the best crew that you could ever imagine. We were 11 months of shooting those two movies, and everybody was still on speaking terms at the end.
I thought that it was actually going to be a great decision because we would be able to keep a lot of consistency as far as the look and the crew and the equipment and so forth. You know, it was going to be a lot easier.
Yeah, that's good. Put a half double in the bottom.
This is what I'm going to need about week six. Can we go and cup of coffee?
Express.
This is great. Bob Z. Thank you very much. It turned out to be, you know, a really interesting time because I got married. My son was born. My father passed away. All these big, huge, you know, kind of seismic shifts in my life happened while I was doing those two movies. But rather than be a distraction or be a burden at that time, they existed as a kind of a continuity for me.
This, but you're in a time machine.
And this is the year 2015?
I've never liked future stories. I've never liked alien stories because they're just the opinion of the filmmaker. I know it's like just stuff that writers just can make up. So it really isn't really, in my opinion, very interesting for me to watch. So the future stuff of the Back to the Future sequel was the least interesting thing for me to do in the entire making of the three movies.
Well, you're the doc, Doc.
Here's our exit.
We did certain amounts of homework where we said, okay, this makes sense as to where it's going to be and where it's going to go. A lot of stuff we knew we were going to get wrong.
But it turns out that our future predictions, we were about 50% right. So we got 50% right and we got 50% wrong. It's not bad.
We knew, really, that we weren't going to have flying cars, but my God, we had to have those.
The flying DeLorean was an all fiberglass shell with retractable wheels, and so that was completely fabricated in my shop and from molds and fiberglass.
Right on the tick.
The second, and as it turned out, third movie, they were a lot of fun to work on, like creating that whole future world, just in terms of sets and props and effects. They were enormously bigger and more expensive movies than the first one. And I think there were maybe 27 people in the art department for number two and three. And we were all thinking about crazy things for the future. I had some specific assignments, like Doc Brown is supposed to have an amphibious flying van. So I did a bunch of sketches for that. Unfortunately, it got written out. And I nursed an idea that John Bell had for this beautiful flying Citroën taxi through to completion. I made working drawings and bid it out and then worked with the shop to get it done. I was a resource available for anyone who wanted some crazy thing designed and drawn.
He'll be right over here, and then just as he's turning around from that, we'll have this hologram of Jaws come out and try to bite him.
It made me feel like I wasn't given a movie assignment, but I was given an experience to actually go on those journeys to those places. And because there was something already that was very strong about Hill Valley as presented in the first movie, I could build upon that as a production designer, and then with all the input that Bob and Bob could give me, to actually feel free to project myself into the future.
The future.
In the era of Blade Runner and Brazil and all of that, to project ourselves from the 80s to a place where there was a balance with nature and the park and the pond, and then all these sort of free-form architectural styles that I could bring to bear into the square, I found that I was able to kind of see it as an optimistic look forward into a world that I hoped would be.
In Back to the Future 2, on the square, both Bob and Bob paid tribute to all kinds of things, both in their personal past and to filmmakers, giving a nod to filmmakers. In one such case, they had this hologram for Jaws in 3D, you know, coming out of the movie theater.
Shark still looks fake.
On another one, if you look on the scoreboard, because Bob's from Chicago, there's a huge proclamation up there that says, Cubs win World Series.
Against Miami?
Yeah, something, huh? Who would have thought? 100-1 shot.
I remember when I saw the film, one of the things I said was, well, you know that poster in the alley that says Surf Vietnam? That's never going to happen. And now here we are, and I was wrong. I mean, these guys are almost prescient, some of the things that they came up with.
This thing doesn't fit.
I'm adjusting.
The story was that you would get clothing and it would form fit itself to you. So I came up with the idea that it was rubber and that it had these whole sections which would, you know, draw themselves into your body size. And the drying thing, I think, was Bob's idea, that it would sort of be one-stop, do-everything item of clothing.
Your jacket is now dry.
The thing that was great about working with Joanna Johnson, the costume designer, was that we were really very new to the game, both of us. And Joanna brought so much to the table in terms of her imagination of types of materials that would be not really practical right now, but maybe they could become things in the future and worn, like the idea of the two ties, where we came up with shoes that buckle themselves up.
Power laces, all right.
The only thing that I wish had happened was Marty McFly's shoes that lace by themselves. That was the one invention that I was really hoping would happen in the next 2 or 3 years after the movie came out that hasn't happened yet.
How do you play this thing?
I'll show you, kid.
You may spot in the Back to the Future movies Billy Zane and Elijah Wood, who are some of the background characters.
Oh, Sonny, we can do this the easy way or the hard way.
That Bob Z has been able to put into the film with some very astute casting in his early career.
Little girl, stop! Look, I need to borrow your hoverboard.
I believe Bob Gale was the first one to approach me over hoverboarding, and he steered me to Cornell University, where they were experimenting with maglev technology for trains. And I called them and got someone on the phone and asked how it worked and all that. And so we started playing around to see if we could have magnets actually hold something up. We also had plenty of hidden cables and wires flying Michael and Michael's double Charlie all over the place. So pretty much everywhere we went where you see them flying and in the air, they were hanging from piano wire.
There's something very familiar about all this.
Yeah, well, someday I think the hoverboards, will certainly be a reality someday.
Buttheads.
No, I'm sorry, I missed that whole thing. Doing part two was really flying by the seat of our pants, and one of the things being the sequence where I played 1985 Marty, I played my son, I played myself older.
What the hell is this?
I played my daughter.
Mom, is that you?
And the technology that they were using was state-of-the-art at the time. Now it's really outdated, but the genius behind it is really, speaks again to Bob and Steven and their genius.
Starting on Back to the Future 1, Bob Zemeckis formed a relationship with Ken Ralston, who's really one of the premier wizards in visual effects. But when we came to Back to the Future 2, by then Bob was kind of breaking the walls down and decided to really blow it out.
While we were working in London on Roger Rabbit, I said to Ken, I said, so here's what we're going to need to do on Back to the Future 2. We're going to need to come up with a way to put actors in the same shot, duplicating them as three people. And I said, so what are we going to need? And he said, well, we're going to need to build a very serious motion control camera. And I said, well, we should get started on it like now.
No, you just got to have the right touch. Nobody can start this car but me.
Yeah, the bill comes to $302.
300 bucks!
And the ILM guys developed the Tondro motion control system. And it was fabulous. It worked exactly the way we wanted it to.
Aren't you and Jennifer getting along?
Oh, yeah, great, Mom. We're like a couple of teenagers,
One of my fondest memories of that sequence is that there were all the experts were sitting around trying to figure out how to do something, and Bob would let them think for a while, and then Bob Zemeckis would go, no, okay, this is how you have to do it. He was so smart, so ahead of everybody, that he would always figure it out.
But in those days, everything was still being done optically, so nothing in the set could be disturbed between takes. And as a matter of fact, everything was glued down, everything on the walls, every bit of set dressing, anything that wasn't being moved had to be hot glued down with a hot glue gun. Unfortunately, the one night where we locked up the stage and put guards around it so that nothing could be disturbed, and of course, as fate would have it, that we had an earthquake that night. Luckily, it was a small earthquake, so we shot splits that we were owed and put the film together, and we couldn't see anything. So the earthquake really didn't bother anything.
Keep running, sucker! And you tell that realty company that I ain't selling, you hear? We ain't gonna be terrorized!
Well, the template for a dark, second act in a trilogy was set by George Lucas when he made the first three Star Wars. And Empire Strikes Back is clearly the darker of the three films, and for me, the best of the first three Star Wars episode, 4, 5, and 6. And so, yeah, the second act was the dark act, but you have to go into a kind of abyss before you can climb out and become a hero in the spotlight.
You can't be. Drop it. So you're the son of a bitch who's been stealing my newspapers.
Mr. Strickland!
Doing the second one was my favorite because it was so insane.
Oh! Marty McFly! Marty McFly! Don't you know me, sir, from school, sir?
I've never seen you before in my life, but you look to me like a slacker.
And Strickland is suddenly in this house with armor and a shotgun, and there's kids harassing him, going driving by. It's just madness.
Hey, Strickland!
Oh,
cut. So on action, you're both looking out there. You, Jim, are gonna just dive in the house.
On action, will I turn this way, do you think?
Yeah, drop.
At that time, I was filming Back to the Future at night and Dick Tracy during the day, simultaneously. So it was interesting, a challenge.
Action! Window!
I love movies.
Okay, we'll play back A again. Yeah, that was good, Michael. Sure. Good effect.
Boy, you're right about it. You don't act that. You just go, ah!
Okay, good. Next right. Setup.
Well, you know, you don't want to be like, you know, have all that stuff go off and you screw it up. You know what I mean? Like, you forget, you do something wrong and they got to do it all again.
And I love the way number two became so dark. Greed and evil took over. And then in the third one, the whole sky opens up. It's a Western, there's romance, and there's everything gets resolved. And it just had this curve that was wonderful to play, wonderful to do.
It's like we're in hell or something.
No, it's Hill Valley, although I can't imagine hell being much worse.
One of the fun aspects of two was the fact that we were visiting 1985 and Biff had changed the rules. And so we were able to give it a different look, a darker, more affected, sinister time period.
We used to call that Biff horrific. And what I thought about it as is this is a place, especially Biff's apartment, where you just wouldn't want to find your mother.
Michael.
Mom, Zee.
Just relax, Marty. You've been asleep for almost 2 hours.
I had a horrible nightmare. It was terrible.
Well, you're safe and sound now. Back on the good old 27th floor.
27th floor!
Hey!
Ah! Everything's gonna be fine, Marty. Are you hungry? I can call room service.
I didn't really realize what a great part I had in Back to the Future 2 till I saw it. I'm dazzled by my work in that movie, honestly, because that character that I created with the big Zumbas, I was basically playing a drag queen. Honestly, I was. And, you know, I did a lot of work on that character, and it's very sad and upsetting, that scene.
You're supposed to be in Switzerland, you little son of a bitch!
I love that. That's one of my favorite scenes I've ever done in a movie.
What the hell do you care? We can afford it. The least we can do with all that money is to make a better life for our children.
Oh, Marty's your kid, not mine. And all the money in the world wouldn't do jack shit for that lazy bum.
Well, stop it, Biff. Just stop it.
The makeup was extraordinary because these days you have greater facility to do makeup and to age people and to present them in different ways in movies. In those days, you know, you had to tip your hat to the guys who did it in the old-fashioned way, just with subtle prosthetics to make these changes work.
They're doing little touch-ups on us before we do this shot. Always with these pieces, the glue is very strong, but sometimes at these little flaps here, it'll come loose right around here. So they come up and annoy you quite a bit with this little printing and fussing.
Tom was nuts. He's funnier than hell. You couldn't ask for somebody nicer to be in a tough situation with. And we spent more hours together than husband and wife. Because there were such a variety of looks on him, and we switched back and forth all the time.
Magicians, makeup magicians. Thanks, you guys.
It takes an hour, and it looks like a horror movie to take the makeup off.
They worked hard, and it was a long process. And Tom Wilson, he made Biff so real and so powerful that I think that took him by surprise, and that's just the power of film, and it's the power of creating a character.
What are you looking at, butthead? I'm just kidding, I'm a very nice person. They make me do this. If I'm not mean, the checks don't clear, and that's bad.
The thing about Tom, too, is that Tom is just such a gentle giant. He's such a sweet guy. You know, sometimes when you work with guys and you have physical scenes, you have fight scenes or pushing scenes or whatever, it can be a little iffy, because if an actor just needs to do it and be aggressive and be violent, control sometimes is wanting and you can get hurt. But so he was always really measured and really knew what he was doing and all that. But then at the same time, he had a real intensity.
Two McFlys with the same gun.
It's funny, just as I sit here talking about it, I had this kind of sense memory flashback to when we shot a lot of that stuff on the roof of the hotel and falling off and rising up in the DeLorean and all that stuff. Like it was yesterday. I share that. It just came back to me.
Nice shot, Doc! You're not gonna believe this! We gotta go back to 1955!
I don't believe it!
I think the second Back to the Future, it might be the most interesting movie I ever made. It was a once-in-a-lifetime situation that no other filmmaker has ever had before. Because here I had a situation where I was doing a sequel to a time travel movie where a character goes back and visits the original movie. So you have a chance to make the first movie again from another point of view. And it was really something that thrilled me to do it.
Because in the first one I did this.
Did you? You're sure?
Yeah.
Hold
up. Yeah.
All right, well then, the first one in the first movie?
It doesn't match.
Or the first take?
Going back into a movie and looking at it from a different point of view actually presents challenges that you can't even imagine, because you have to go back and recreate a setting and revisit it, but see it from another side. You might see like a dance sequence from backstage instead of front of the stage.
This must be the dance.
It was strange, and it was like a time warp to go back to the same sets and the same costumes. And they actually didn't have my pink dress. They couldn't find them. They made three of them for the first one, and I had taken one. And someone had already sold off, I think, the other two. So they were going to have to remake it. And I said, I have it. And I had it, and I got to wear it.
And I had some brilliant people who did some investigating. And we did find a lot. And if we didn't find the actual, we either copied or we got things which were very, very close.
It had only been 5 years. But man, I hit my knees in the knee slide 5 years later. At 29 instead of 24. Like my legs are like, no, 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 we don't do that anymore. You know, that's enough of that. So it was a little humbling moment, you know.
You don't want to get struck by lightning!
That's the problem with sequels. The audiences have opinions. They want the same movie but different. So what you have to do is you have to say, okay, how do you make the same movie that is different but not too different? The same, but not too much the same. And it's really, really a difficult thing to do. And for a filmmaker, it's not really a fulfilling thing to do. I mean, because you're constantly on that balance beam and you're slave to these opinions and these things that we have to do.
Hey, it's me, it's Martin.
Oh, it can't be. Just sent you back to the future.
Yeah. Oh, I know you did send me back to the future, but I'm back. I'm back from the future.
Movies should be experimental.
Great.
Especially reinforced and emboldened by the massive success of the first Back to the Future. The guys took some tremendous risks, but you can't get up in the morning if you're a director like Bob Zemeckis without doing something which is seemingly on the surface brash and unpopular. I mean, Bob has to push that envelope.
We finished shooting Back to the Future 2, and then we all went up to Sonora, California to Back to the Future 3. And Back to the Future 2 had a release date, so we had to get the cut right. We had to get Bob in again in the evening, and that was very difficult because he was shooting another movie.
Bob would finish shooting Back to the Future 3. He'd get on a private plane. They'd fly him down to the Burbank Airport. Bob would come in, we'd sit down, he'd have dinner. I'd play back for him the sound mix that I'd supervised during the day. Bob would give his notes, he would make changes. We'd work for a couple hours with the sound crew, getting it right. Bob would go to the Sheraton Universal, he'd go to sleep. He'd wake up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. Car would take him to Burbank Airport. He'd go back and shoot. And he did that for about 2 weeks. So it was insane.
Well, I think there's, you know, it could be dangerous to leave the audience with an unsatisfying end in the second movie. But what was great is we were shooting the third movie and we could cut a trailer to attach to the end of the second movie to say, hey, wait a minute, don't get upset. There's going to be a third movie that's going to wrap everything up.
1885. Amazing. I actually end up as a blacksmith in the Old West.
Pretty heavy, huh?
I think every time that we were talking about Back to the Future, the opportunity was there to explore a different genre. And there's very few movie-making experiences I can think of where you really totally get the opportunity to do that, because we're dipping into science fiction and then dipping into an action adventure and then trying something that was a full-blown Western. And you're inside of storytelling that Bob was doing where anything goes.
Haven't you ever seen a Western?
Yeah, I have, Doc. And Clint Eastwood never wore anything like this.
When I did it, I realized why so many directors enjoyed doing Westerns, because it's kind of like camping out. You know, you're there, and it was always quiet. Doing a Western is quiet. And the reason it's quiet is there's no vehicles. All the base camp is way far away, and, you know, the actors are run up to the settings, electric golf carts. So all you have are these horses. It's nice and quiet. It's peaceful.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, I'd go fishing almost every day when I wasn't working, and just to rattle around the sets. And again, you have things you have to do, whether it's you know, work with a quick draw expert with the guns, or whether it was take horseback riding lessons and figure out how to handle a horse next to the train and all that stuff. So there's always stuff to do. But then the moments of peace were really peaceful.
Bob and I grew up in the 50s and 60s, and the Western was a staple of television. We love Westerns, and I think shooting Back to the Future 3 was probably the most fun I've had shooting any movie, because I got to go to work wearing a cowboy hat. And then to go to Monument Valley and walk in John Ford's footsteps, that was movie heaven. And we stayed at Goulding's Lodge, where John Ford and John Wayne used to stay. It was just the best.
Okay, let's shoot.
When someone says, I want this to be like a John Ford movie, they don't usually say, I want you to actually go into Monument Valley and shoot. Then let's say they say they want you to shoot. That's great. But to build a drive-in theater in Monument Valley where you see the buttes that are actually reflected in the big mural, which has all the Indians charging, and then send the DeLorean straight at it so that when it hits 88 miles per hour, that will all disappear. And of course, come right into an Indian charge.
Indian!
Ah! Action, Michael.
Mom, is that you?
They're there now. You've been asleep for nearly 6 hours now.
I love doing Westerns, and I loved doing an Irish accent. It was really, really fun. That town that they built was amazing. I remember going for the first time to the set and, like, kind of going over a hill, and it was an entire city that they had created.
We built everything on site. There was nothing done in the West that was not a part of that town. So all the interiors that you see are interiors with exteriors. So it, after a very short time, felt like a real town. And in parts, we didn't even finish because that was part of the look of the movie. Yeah! Ah!
I thought the Western parts of Back to the Future 3 were as good as some of the scenes in My Darling Clementine. The bar, for instance, just the production design of that bar. It was large, it was audacious, it was the way those saloons really were back in the 19th century. And I just thought that Western could challenge any other Western that had ever been made without time travel.
And action!
That was really fun. I mean, to be able to be a filmmaker and just order up an 1880s town is fantastic. And we built that entire Western town right where that train track was.
That's it!
How fast did she go? Why, I've had her up to 55 myself.
There is one operating steam locomotive west of the Rockies, and that is in Jamestown, California, up near Sonora. And in the original skateboard chase in part one, there was a gag where Marty got away from Biff, not with a manure truck, but by skateboarding in front of an oncoming train, and the train cuts off Biff's car from getting across the tracks and going after him. So we actually scouted this area and that train for that sequence, which for budget reasons we couldn't do. So we were familiar with the fact that there was this train up there. And the location was very picturesque, just beautiful area.
Marty, I gave you explicit instructions not to come here, but to go directly back to 1985.
I know, Doc, but I had to come.
But it's good to see you, Marty.
All good drama needs a character arc. The characters need to grow, they need to change, and one of the challenges of doing Back to the Future 2 and 3 was to give Marty a place to go, because the first movie was really about George's character arc and his change.
Are you okay?
So we had to give Marty this weakness that nobody calls me chicken.
You chicken?
And use that as an element and as his problem that's gonna get solved.
Nobody calls me yellow.
And we needed Doc to have an arc as well. And we thought, wouldn't it be interesting if in the third movie, Doc and Marty change places?
Great Scott.
I know, this is heavy.
That Doc becomes the more irresponsible character because he has fallen in love and wants to stay with his true love and not give a damn about the space-time continuum. And Marty is the voice of science and reason.
You're a scientist. So you tell me, what's the right thing to do up here?
Love finds Doc Brown. And it was great that Doc had his turn in having an emotional story. And the fact that he became just struck down like a lovesick puppy. And that was getting in the way of the plot and getting back to the present.
Wherever you go, and take me with you.
I can't, Clara. I wish it didn't have to be this way, but just believe me when I tell you that I'll never forget you. And that I love you.
My kids had really been fans of the original film, and turned me onto it. I really loved it. I loved the magic of it. And having done a time travel movie, my second film, Time After Time, was a time travel movie. So I already loved the genre.
We didn't have a second choice. We didn't know who to go to if she said no. And the three of us were thinking, God, please let her say yes. Please let her say yes, because if she says no, what do we do?
I remember Steven telling me that they were very nervous that I would say no. I don't recall ever contemplating saying no, so I don't know what they were so nervous about. I was excited to work with all of them, but it's funny and I guess a little flattering that they thought they had to woo me. And Chris Lloyd had been in my first film, Going South, so I already loved Chris. It wasn't a long walk to pretend like I adored him.
I loved it. First of all, I love working with Mary Steenburgen.
Good evening.
Evening.
We worked before, and I just felt that it was perfectly cast, you know, great chemistry. And it's like Doc discovering another world. I don't think he ever thought about relationships or women, and he's thinking about space travel and all his other experiments, and it was just a shock.
You've read Jules Verne.
I adore Jules Verne.
So do I.
I loved the idea of two kind of geeks, because both of us are geeks. I'm someone who reads Jules Verne and who studies the stars and who is interested in some of the same things that he's interested in. So it's before there became such a thing in movies, kind of geek love.
Well, the future, oh, I can tell you about the future.
That's the thing about Chris again. He's a classically trained actor. He's a serious guy and knows how to get to the heart of a character. And so I think he just loved having that chance with Doc to take him to that vulnerable place and to have him kind of baffled by things that he couldn't explain through science or through trial and error, that he had to take risks of the heart.
An interesting part about the transition between Back to the Future 2 and 3 was for Christopher Lloyd, because up till then he was the eccentric, crazy old man. But now we have to look at him a little different in part 3. Now we have to think of him as a love interest for a relatively young lady that was quite a bit younger than him in look.
I treasured working with the great costume designer Joanna Johnston. We were both very inspired, as was Bob Zemeckis, by John Ford's movies, and we wanted to create in Clara a heroine that had some of the romance of John Ford's heroines. And it was also important that I be able to move in them. And I loved what she came up with.
I wanted her to stand out and be very kind of heroic, and it was a very particular color in that period, that extraordinary sort of vibrant violet. Purple, and my idea was that she would have be this sort of wonderful ping of optimism and color and vibrancy, I suppose, really. But the other thing that happened is that when she started the journey of that sequence in the dress, the sun in Sonora was so hot that the dress started fading. It started taking this sort of pinkish hue, and we had to keep on making more dresses to complete the sequence because it was awful. It literally changed colors in front of our eyes.
Experiment.
One of the things I realized when I was doing the Back to the Future 3 was why filmmakers love doing movies about trains. Because the thing that's really great about a train is it's on a track. So to create action, tension, and suspense, there's one thing that the filmmaker doesn't have to spend a lot of time explaining to the audience, which is where the train is going. Because it's always going to be on the track. So to create a giant sequence at the end with a train is a filmmaker's dream.
I'll say, Doc, you know, come in. He'll listen to his walkie-talkie, and I'll lift it up, and I'll say, we're going at 25 miles an hour.
Okay, we're cruising at a steady 25 miles an hour, Doc. Damn it!
My father was a freight train conductor, so trains are very important to me.
Toby, I'm going to tell you this, guy.
And I love to ride. I'm actually a little better rider now than I was when we did Back to the Future 3, although that is me riding up to the back of the train and touching it. My stunt double did the transfer, but I trained pretty hard to be able to do that.
Steve Gawley at that time was at the top of his game as a model maker. And model making was an incredibly useful and necessary craft in trying to turn these fantasies into reality. And so actually shooting the miniature set of the train flying off the cliff at the end of the movie was spectacular. And I actually remember I was on one of the cameras because they ran out of operators. So what it was is we went to this hillside, Marin, close to where ILM was, and they laid a beautiful miniature track. And in fact, the train itself was pretty large scale. And I just couldn't believe that here was this beautiful train and one shot we're gonna blow the thing up. So, you know, we sent that thing off the cliff and just prayed that no one missed the shot and that everything worked properly, which it did.
I loved all the characters in Back to the Future.
What's wrong? We thought you went to the lake.
You wore that to the lake?
And Wendy Jo Sperber, just a wonderful, wonderful actress, a firecracker of an actress. She sort of is our good luck charm. We want to put her in all of our movies. But in Back to the Future too, she was pregnant at the time, and she couldn't do the part. And we saved Wendy for the very end of Back to the Future 3. But it was just a tragic loss that Wendy had breast cancer and left the world too soon. Her spirit lives on through her foundation, the We Spark Foundation, and it's a terrific charity for the families of cancer victims.
Wendy was a happy, happy girl, big smile. You can close your eyes and just picture that smile, and she's, you know, it's so cool, and it was nice to be able to cross paths with her in my lifetime, no doubt.
You're gonna miss him,
Jen. A sequence like the train taking off at the end, you know, starts with the design. And so they design this wonderful Jules Verne-like train. and we went and shot on this railroad crossing.
That train had to be built from scratch. It's a shell, but all of the gizmos on it had to work. You know, the stairs, the door open. I think we had a Jeep inside of it that drove it down the tracks, and it was a huge build. It took us months to build that thing. And then, of course, when it takes off, Ken Ralston, up at ILM at that time, would have to match it.
So it was a carefully designed sequence with a wonderfully designed train that started practical and ended in the world of visual effects.
I think at the end, we all felt a tremendous feeling of accomplishment, and we were proud of it. It worked.
Come on, buddy!
The actual thrill ride of the movie was there, and that was great. But it had a deeper thing. It had these characters and these relationships and these big questions, these kind of... These are the Greeks have been asking these questions. I mean, these are old, big questions that we have, and it had humor, and it had so much going for it beyond just the visceral thrills.
Your future is whatever you make it. So make it a good one. Both of you.
So I think that, you know, it's just a great coming together of a lot of different people and a lot of different talents that was just unique. And I don't think you'd find it today.
The guys had a story in their brains that was rattling around up there, and they had to get it out. And they had two other stories, and that's all she wrote. And that's all there will ever be of Back to the Future.
Enough is enough. Actually, I believe that just basically in the numerology of it, you know, there's tension in threes. Three, a three-act play. Four is not a dramatic number. Four is an even, calm, relaxed number. So I think three is the perfect amount of sequels that any movie should be done.